Welcome to my secret place devotion with Oyeks Alfred. The Word of God is alive and equipped to change your life.
Good morning.
A king in the Bible called Uzziah, God did something wonderful for him. The Bible says that God helped him against the Philistines. His story is recorded in 2 Chronicles 26, verse 7. I want us to pray so that we'll have the same experience that this king had. We'll have that experience this year. Lord, thank you so much for all the wonderful things you do for your children. I pray today for them, Lord, that you will help them greatly. That this entire year, they will see your mighty hand of help at work in their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. If you follow that devotional, you know that this period we've been talking about the salvation of the soul. Most people don't realize that their soul needs to be saved. They know the spirit needs to be saved, but they don't realize or recognize or appreciate the fact that their soul needs to be saved. The Bible makes it very clear in James chapter 1 verse 21 that our souls should be saved. Inside our soul, we have the will, we have the emotion, and we have our intellect. So these three must be saved. But the question today is, what does a saved will look like? When a man's will is saved, how do we know that this man's will is saved? Now, an unsaved will is a will that is not fully submitted to the Lord, and it is a dangerous will. When your will is your own, you do exactly what you want to do, you say exactly what you want to say, that means your will is not yet saved, and it is a self-destructive will, because the Bible tells us in Proverbs 14 verse 12, it said that there is a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. So if you insist on following your own way, the Bible says that pattern leads to destruction. That is why a will that is not saved, a will that is not submitted to God, is a destructive will, because it will lead you your own way. That way may look good, that way might look great, but that way leads to destruction. And if you look at your life where you have disobeyed God, you will see that those times you disobeyed God, you've seen the consequences of disobeying God. The reason people disobey God is simply because their will is not yet saved. Their will does not belong to God. So they still do the things they want to do, irrespective of what God wants them to do. Now, there are two dimensions of an unsaved will, and I want to take a look at it, the two of the dimensions. The first dimension has to do with your decision-making process. When a man's will is saved, it's going to look like what happened in 2 Samuel chapter 2, verse 1. I read it from the New Living Translation. It says, after this, David asked the Lord, should I move back to one of the towns of Judah? Yes, the Lord replied. Then David asked, which town should I go to? To Hebron, the Lord answered. Most people don't function like this. You see, David was an Israelite, and he could have, you know, lived in any city in Judah that he wanted, but he didn't want to just take a decision on his own. He went to God and asked him, Lord, should I go to Judah? And God said yes. For most people, that's enough. God has said yes, and they'll move on. But you see, David went a step further and said, okay, you know what? In Judah, where exactly should I go to Judah? And God answered him, in Hebron. If you read the story of David, you find out that David will always make inquiries of the Lord. He will keep asking God, constantly asking God. All those men in the Bible who walked with God, one of the things you notice is that they didn't take decisions on their own. They constantly asked God, what do you want me to do? They were very open to the will of God for their lives part time. So a saved will is that will that is, you know, in making decisions. It doesn't just jump off and take a job, move wherever, marry anybody, do certain things. He always wants to find the will of God. If you read from Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, he said, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. So the scripture is telling us that you have your own understanding. You know how things should be. But he said, don't depend on that understanding. Don't lean on that understanding. If you depend on your understanding, you are going to make a mistake. But the Bible says, acknowledge the Lord in all your ways. In other words, the things you want to do, tell God about it and allow him to help you and guide you. That is one dimension of a saved will. It is a will that constantly wants to know, you know, the will of God for him in one area or the other. Now, the second dimension of a saved will is in terms of absolute obedience to God. The moment you know what God wants you to do, you actually do it. If we read from Matthew chapter 5, verse 39 to 41. It says, however, I say to you, don't repay an evil act with another evil act. But whosoever insults you by slapping you on the right cheek, turn the other to him as well. If someone is determined to sue you for your coat, give him the shirt of your back as a gift in return. And should people in authority take advantage of you, do more than what they demand. So, I mean, this is a tough call. But what the Bible is saying, that if people insult you and disregard you and take advantage of you, the Bible says, you know what? Give them even more than they demand. That is talking about a saved will. That is absolute obedience to the commands of God. You know, the commands that are written in the Bible, they are tough on the flesh. Because, you know, who would want to allow himself to be taken advantage of? Who would want to allow his coat to be taken? Nobody in the flesh. But that's why God wants us saved. Whenever God gives you an instruction, he knows why. So most of those instructions in the Bible, they are tough on the flesh. But if you will just trust that God knows what he's doing and obey him, you will see how your life will turn out. Let's read from Matthew chapter 5, verse 44. It says, however, I say to you, love your enemy. Bless the one who curses you. Do something wonderful for the one who hates you. And respond to the ones who persecute you by praying for them. Now, this is a tall order for the flesh. It's not easy to do. But a saved will is the will that will obey God to the letter. Once he has seen it in the scripture, how he feels is no more important. What he thinks is no more important. It is what God said that he does. That is how you know a will is saved. For instance, somebody may have upset you and yet that person needs help. Guess what you are supposed to do? According to this scripture, he says you're going to go out of your way to help the person. In fact, those who are persecuting you are the number one people you should pray about. Those who hate you are the number one people you should actually do something wonderful for. Those who curse you are the number one people you should bless. And those who hate you are the number one people that you should love. According to Matthew chapter 5, verse 44. The next verse, that's 45, says, this is how you prove you are God's own children. Because you are doing exactly what God wants you to do, irrespective of how you feel. That is how you know a will is saved. That is how you know that a will is surrendered to the Lord. First dimension is he asks God's opinion before he takes decisions. Small or big decisions, he asks God. The second dimension is he obeys the word of God no matter what he thinks or feels. It doesn't matter. What counts is what God has said he should do. This is the sign of a saved will. Thank you for listening. God bless you. Have a tremendous day ahead.
For other life-changing messages, you can now download the app Rev Oyik Speaks from Play Store for Android phone users or Apple Store for iOS users. You can also follow us on Instagram, YouTube, and Telegram, all on the handle OyigsAlfred.